Hello everyone, I'm Katarzyna Olszewska, I'm cinematic animator and previous layout artist. It's really nice to meet you here on this year's edition of Digital Dragons. At the beginning, I want to tell you a few words about me. During years of my work, I work on different projects as a character animator and as a previous and layout artist. And I worked on commercials, I worked on game cinematics, on some interactive performances, on movies, short movies, TV series, and AAA games. And these are like just few projects I worked on. They are all very different, and my goal in my work is to take best from all of them and implement to my work to increase the quality and develop new techniques. And that inspired me to talk to you today about movies and how movies influence our storytelling and in games, and how we can implement some movie techniques into our games. So let's start from the beginning. What exactly do these two projects have in common? The arrival of the train, created by Lumiere Brother, was one of the first movies. And Space War, by Steven Russell, was one of the first games which was publicly presented to the wide audience. There is almost 60 years difference between them, but these two projects have one important thing in common. They are both considered as the beginning of two biggest in the entertainment industries. And even they look so different, they have actually a lot of things in common. Both of them tells the story. First one, the arrival of the train, is the story of train which arrives to the station and the story of people who are getting into the train or leaving the train. Space War is a story about the ship which shoots its enemies. They are both very simple, but it shows how less we actually need to tell the stories we have in our minds. From the beginnings, movies were focused on telling the story. Filmmakers were experimenting with composition, editing, camera movement for over 125 years. And during these years of practice, they created basic rules of visual storytelling and grammar of film language. Game industry is much younger. First games were focused mostly on scores and challenges. And during years of experiments, developments, and technical improvements, this industry evolved and started to implement more and more complicated stories and develop more realistic characters. Nowadays, both movies and games are telling the stories. So let's see what's the actual difference between them, what makes them unique. Movies are passive. They are 100% designed and always the same. We, as a viewer, we are always experiencing them exactly the same way, exactly the same story, exactly the same pictures. In games, games are active. We, as a player, we have an actual influence on what's happening on the screen. Every playthrough is different and unique. In some ways, games are more complicated than movies because they demand not only good visual storytelling, but also connected with interesting gameplay. And this leads us to a very important question. What's more important, story or gameplay? In years, I heard a lot of arguments for both, for and against both of them. But actually, the answer for this question is very simple. None of them. Both of them are important on the same level. Story and gameplay are not just important as itself. They cooperate and influence each other all the time. So we shouldn't think about them as a two separate thing. The best games are the ones which tell the story and create emotion during the whole playthrough. Best ones connect gameplay and the story in one designed structure. And in that kind of games, every collectible, every weapon, and every character movement which appears in the game has its background and explanation in the story, and that makes the whole game experience more believable. And like in here, we have two examples of Uncharted, the gameplay and the cinematics. They are both connected. Everything what's happening in the gameplay in this game, like collectibles, like stories which happen, even which the stories which happened in the previous game, they are mentioned in the cutscenes. Like in this one, Nathan is telling some his stories and his adventures, which appeared actually in the previous games. So that shows how gameplay and the cutscene and so this whole story itself is connected. So as you can see, in both movies and games, we have to think about the project as one consequent and solid structure. So for better understanding of visual storytelling, let's look at the production pipeline of the movie and see which parts of this pipeline we can actually use in our game production. As we can see, 3D movie production pipeline is not so different than the game production pipeline. All of the steps in pre-production and production are the same. The idea, the story, script, asset, characters, animation, the idea is the same, they are the same. And if we add the technical and artistic development of gameplay mechanics and level design, we got a strong, solid base to create a AAA game. Nice aspect of creating game and game pipeline is we don't have to worry about the whole post-production and we don't have to waste thousands of hours on rendering. Everything in our games is generated in real time. And that allows us to see almost immediately effects of our work directly into the game. So for better understanding how movie pre-production and production influence our game production, let's look closely to some of the most important steps. First is story. Story is always important. And the script is a fundamental part of every story. And there's one basic rule on every story and script. If you have a good script, you can make from it a really good movie or a really bad one. But if you have a bad script, you can make only a bad movie. And this applies also to games. If we have a bad script and boring characters, there is no way we'll create an amazing game. Even if we have an amazing gameplay, there is no way that our players will be satisfied. And in this case, they will rate our game as an average. And that's not our goal. In years, movie industry developed specific way to create a script, a special font, and many rules how the proper script should look like. And some of them you can see on the screen, how mark characters, how mark location, what are the distances between the dialogues, and how the composition of the whole script should look like. And this structure allows actors, producer, and artists to communicate during the production. And what's more important, one page of the script, it's one page of the, it's 1 second, it's 1 minute of the movie. And that allows a very fast understanding of length and complexity of every scene. In games, we have a slightly more difficult situation because we have to include gameplay. So very often we use Excel sheets or other massive files to plan the whole game. But still it's good to convert the main story of our game into this kind of movie script. This kind of movie script is very useful for previous artists, animators, and of course actors. Because I cannot imagine going to the motion capture session, meet with the actors and work with them with 1,000 pages of Excel files. It's totally impossible. And here we have two examples. And one is from Riders of the Lost Ark. And this is the actual script which was used in the movie by Harrison Ford. And the other one is The Last of Us, first part. And we can see that the game script was created in the Excel file with all gameplay on and all important annotations. But it was also transformed into proper movie script. And in green, we have to mark in there the main parts of gameplay and where, when they are appearing and it's what's happening in this particle places in the gameplay. When we have our script and our story, we can move on. Another element which came from movies industry and influenced game production is storyboard. And this is the first attempt to transfer our movie or cutscene from the writing to visual story. Good storyboards are prepared using composition and editorial rules. And this is the best way to test some ideas, plan the production, and communicate between the members of the team. But before we start to work on storyboard story game, we have to know which types of cutscene will have in our game. And we have two different types of cutscene, first person and third person. And decision what type of cutscene we have in our game influences the whole concept of visual storytelling and emotional experience. First person cutscenes, like you can see on the right side, they have a special connection with the player. First-person view gives the player a feeling that he is actually the character he is playing. But from the production point of view, it creates a lot of limitations. In this type of cutscenes, creators have to resign from some elements of visual storytelling, like editing or using very different lenses. When we are using the third-person cutscenes, they are much more similar to movies, as you can see on the left side on the screen. They are much more similar to movies. They give us much more visual techniques, like using different lenses and editing. And we can use them creating the cutscene, but we as a player are the witness of the events in the game, and we are experiencing them as a witness, like we are experiencing them watching the movies. But what's more important, it doesn't mean that we are less engaged in the game. It's just a different way of how we are experiencing the game. And in here, we have these two examples from Call of Duty, which is very interesting because they use two types of cutscenes, first person and third person in one game. So let's look at the design of the cutscenes. When we already have a script and fundamental knowledge of our game, we are starting to design the cutscene. But before we take action to our 3D software and start to create it, we have to ask ourselves a few very important questions. What our cutscene is about? So we have to really know what will be happening in our cutscene. What's in the script? So what's actually the dialogues? What's the script is telling us about emotion, this kind of stuff? What's the main point of the cutscene? So what is the most important part we want to show the viewer during this cutscene? What's happening in the gameplay before and after our cutscenes? As the cutscenes are part of the game, they have to connect with the gameplay. So we have to remember about this combination. And when we know what's happening before the gameplay, we can design the way how to transform from the gameplay to our cutscene, and later from our cutscene to the gameplay, which is happening after our cutscene. We also have to know, is it the action or acting sequence? Because this influences how we'll be working with our cameras. Later, we also have to know the base establishments of our game. If this is first person games, if you have some specific rules, how we are dealing with the dialogues. They are all things which are very often designed for the whole game. Also, and creating our cutscene, we have to have these establishments in our minds. We have to know what emotions we want to present, so what our characters actually feel and how they are presenting. And we have to know also what emotions should player feel, because very often there are two different things. Characters are behaving and feeling in some way, but we as a player, we can also feel totally different things. And we have to know and control this to make our viewer feel exactly what we want. And of course, we have to know where our casting is happening. What's the environment? How we can use the environment to make our story more interesting. And when we already have the answer for all of these questions, we can decide which visual storytelling techniques will help us achieve our goal. And these are few basic elements we can use creating our cutscenes of visual storytelling. And as you can see, it's not just camera movement, editing, and acting. We can use so many different elements like lighting, like music, like special effects and composition. And knowing all of these elements and having the idea about our cutscenes, we can transform them into previs. Previs is the first stage of bringing our story into life, and it's extremely important. It's the time when for the first time we create the whole sequence. And now we are involved in the first step of the production, because everything we do in this point and from this point has an actual impact on what will be in the final game, especially editing and cameras. And as a creating a previs is very time consuming, takes a lot of effort and money. For movies, it's used for all 3D productions and for the movies which demands very complicated special effects. And as you can see on our two examples from Fantastic Beasts and Resident Evil, the usage of previs is very helpful, and it lets us for the first time see on the screen our story. Creating the cutscene is not easy. So I want to show you an example from The Last of Us Part 2. And this cutscene is, I believe, the best cutscene I have ever seen in the games. And it's for many reasons, so let's look at it closely. This whole sequence has around 4 minutes. And it includes just 9 shots. And when we look at them closely, we can realize that we have just 2 shots with 2 cameras, which they are moving. We have 6 shots, which includes, which have only very small noise, and they are based on 2 camera placements with only small adjustment for composition. And one last shot is long 1 minute shot, which shows only our main character's face. This whole sequence is very simple, but actually it took a lot of effort to design something so powerful. All cameras, sounds, lighting, every aspect supports actors in their acting. Changing even a small detail in the sequence, for example, adding more dynamic noise to all of the cameras, will distract the viewer and completely destroy emotional feeling. And I would like you to show, I would like to show you this one minute shot.
20 seconds and counting. 15 seconds, guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9, ignition sequence start.
Sequence is in this 1 minute shot. As you can see, the whole story about Ellie going to space is told only by sound, lighting, acting, and proper camera movement. And this shot is an amazing example how movie techniques can be used in games to tell the story. This whole sequence shows how powerful simplicity can be. Because very often when we think about games, we mostly think about action shot and then dynamic camera movement. But the truth is that more and more games are now focused on emotions. And good usage of movie technique has an enormous influence of final perception of emotion in games. When you are telling the story, you can also use another technique. It's a master shot. This master shot, it makes our story look like one long shot. And it gives the viewer a feeling that they are with the characters for a whole time, that 1 minute or 1 hour of a viewer's experience is 1 minute of, or 1 hour of our character experience. And this kind of storytelling was used, for example, in these two projects in Birdman, Oscar-winning movie, and Amazing Game God of War. These kinds of projects are very difficult to make because they demand a lot of preparations, and even they look like one long master shot. The skilled eye will easily catch places where some cuts were made because it would be too difficult, too more complicated to create them really as one long master shot. And we can use the idea of master shot in a totally different way. It can be used in the action sequences. And in these two examples, we can see how clever camera movement may tell us very complicated action story. And what's very important for in the example from A Way Out, we can see how this kind of master shot may be used not only to tell the actions and the whole action sequence, but also to switch between the players and switch between the characters we are playing and connect it with the cutscenes. As you can see, even the aspect ratio of our movie even had changed and transferred somewhere else when we are coming back to the game. Very important part of creating cutscenes and gameplay is camera movement and composition. When we are telling the story in a visual way, every shot counts, every composition counts. And it matters in both cutscenes and gameplay. And in these two examples from Star Wars and from The Last of Us Part 2, we can see how we can use, for example, the environment in a clever way to make our composition in the sequence look interesting. And it counts for both movies, cutscenes, and in the gameplay. Another interesting aspect which we can use in creating our games is using some different style. In movies, it's very common when we are telling some inside the movie, we are telling some other story, or we are using some memories of our characters. We use a different visual style to emphasize this part. And like in here in Harry Potter, we have the story of three brothers, which was connected with the shoot from the actual movie, but the whole sequence is created in particular style in CG. And we have the same example of using this technique in Rise, Son of Rome, when we had a normal, natural gameplay and the part of the game is the story which one character tells to another, and the whole story is created in some specific visual style. And what makes it very interesting for the player. Movies influence games very often. They were first, and now as a game creators, we can use the knowledge and ideas which were presented in the movies. And really cool example how movies can influence the games is Red Dead Redemption. We have an awesome games about West and Western, and all movies created in the past, like Rio Bravo in 1959, they all inspired this kind of game to make it like really awesome with this special style and special character. But it's not always that movies just influence games. Very often games also influence movies. And in here we have a really cool example of Wreck-It Ralph. It's an amazing animation which was inspired not only by different styles of game, but also by the history of games. And other interesting example is Hardcore Henry. It's a movie which was inspired by first-person shooters. And the whole movie was recorded from our main character point of view. But creating an adaptation both from movie to games and from games to movies, it's not so easy. Even movies and games are using the same visual storytelling techniques. They are very different in many aspects. It looks so easy to transform, because we have a character, we have a story. It looks so easy to transform them from one medium to another, but it's not so simple. And many adaptations are not as good as the originals. Some techniques of telling the story used in gameplay won't work in movie adaptation. So if you want to create a good movie based on a game, we have to approach the story from totally different perspective and implement changes which adapt the story to this passive way of experience. Movies and games, they are with us, they are our entertainment industries. Games are still new, they are evolving, they are developing, and they are connecting these two different approaches into one complex experience. We have over 125 years of experience in filmmaking. We developed so many techniques of visual storytelling. We don't have to waste time and develop them again for games. We can use them and develop new techniques, which will be unique for the game experience. So I want to encourage all of you, if you are developing your own game, or you have a brilliant idea which one day will transform into the game, watch movies, learn by heart grammar or film language, grammar of film language, combine it with your gameplay experience to make one consistent integrity. Every game has a gameplay and a story, even the simplest one. They don't exist without each other, and none of them is more important than the other one. And if you remember that, and you can find a balance between them, you have a chance to create something truly amazing. Thank you very much for your attention. It was great to meet you all today. I hope our meeting inspired you to look at games and movies from slightly different perspective. If you have any questions, or you just want to talk about movies, games, feel free to contact me. And now have a great day and enjoy your time on Digital Dragons. Bye, guys.